Reminding me about recording because I had paused it. Yes, we've kept this small to facilitate discussion today. And this particular session is going to be moderated by our own Dr. Chelda Smith. She is an associate professor with our Department of Elementary and Special Ed in our College of Education. Her interests include the sociology of education, critical pedagogy and critical literacy, and asset-based pedagogy. And she has also been one of our OER heroes. So I am going to help her monitor chat this morning. Again, we want this to be conversational, but if you're not speaking, please keep your mic muted. Otherwise, feel free to unmute. Just try not to talk over anybody. You may also use chat to place comments or questions, and I will help field those, okay? So I will now turn it over to Dr. Chelda Smith.
Hi, everyone. Thank you so much for joining me for this conversation today. Out of curiosity, are we all in the Statesboro, Savannah area?
No, I'm from Tennessee. I'm in Jackson, Tennessee.
Hi. Oh, my goodness. That's wonderful. Hi, Scott. Anyone else, like, not in that particular, in our particular region right now? Well, this is good to know. Hopefully you have been accessing open educational resources for a while. Maybe you have and you didn't know that you were doing so. So I wanna give a little bit of context as to how I came to open educational resources and then to see where you all are. And then maybe we can talk about like how to access better resources, how to use the library at the university or wherever institution you're at. I see one person is at Julia P, so the school system access there. Just sort of trade tips on how to improve our access and our use and usability of open educational resources. Sound okay? Okay, so I, back in 2015, I had just found out about the Affordable Learning Grant. Is everybody familiar with that, the ALG grant? Okay. Jamie, you know it? No. Okay. I'm so happy to explain it. I'm very excited because I'm an ALG champion. So this is what I do for fun. And so the Affordable Learning Grant is a grant that the state of Georgia offers to faculty or instructors or educators who are currently using a textbook in their class or in a series of classes, and they offer you a grant to find open educational resources to replace that textbook. And so you get some funds, you can do it in a group of two or more. And it's really exciting because oftentimes textbooks, and this is one I'm working on right now, oftentimes textbooks can be really dated. They are, you know, they were written in a certain year at a certain time with as much information as possible from a certain number of perspectives. But well, as you know, the internet where open educational resources exist has things that are way more current, up to date. If, you know, if we decide in our respective fields to change language about a terminology. So for instance, in second language acquisition, we went from English language learners, so ELL, to English learners, EL. Well, your textbook is not going to update that, but newest articles will have that new language, new resources created, even new websites, but just websites that talk about these things will update that our respective field has decided that this is the preferred language for this particular group of people. And so I'm really a big supporter of open ed resources, specifically for the field that I'm in, because it's always changing. I'm in the field of diversity and cultural issues. And so the more we learn about how to bring marginalized identities into the center, the more we create language or evolve language around that group. And so I did that in 2015. I replaced the textbook with a series of articles and videos and even some podcasts. We built it through our digital library, our digital commons library. And what was really exciting about it is we got to watch as students engaged it. If you've ever taught a class and you don't know if your student has your textbook, sometimes that's a financial barrier, sometimes that's an interest barrier or a combination of the two. But with open educational resources, everybody has the textbook, so to speak. And then there's all these like, this is not my field where I'm gonna try, so I'm gonna stumble through this, but there are all these analytical ways that we can monitor who is, how long they're reading the resources, how much they're accessing them. So what hits for students, what's really great, what isn't. And so that's what ALG supports us to do. And I did that again, 2015. And now last year with a group of 5 other faculty members, we submitted an even larger grant to do the same thing, because now instead of having a textbook for a class, we've actually decided to create a textbook, an open ed textbook for an entire degree program. And so our faculty will be able to access this, our students will be able to access it, and we're co-creating content with our students. We're also pulling great content that's already online. We're co-creating content with our faculty just so that really everybody's on the same page and everybody has the same degree of access. So that's a lot about me. Any questions or comments?
Not seeing any in chat, so.
Okay, thank you, thank you.
I'm sorry I took so long. I was trying to turn on my mic. But one comment that I would like to raise, Sheldon, I hope that you'll address this, is that it seems to me that there's a misunderstanding between OER and low-cost, no-cost courses. I often, as I'm exploring this topic, I see that those terms kind of substituted for each other. So I hope that our conversation will include the distinction between those two and how that sometimes they are the same and often they're not.
Thank you so much, Nancy. And Nikki, I'm gonna ask you to help me as I answer this question, because it is a wonderful one. And I think because we don't have a whole bunch of conversation happening right now, it's a great one to start with. So the open educational resources, the nature of them being open means that they are no cost. So all of the courses in the Masters of Arts in Elementary Education that will use that library guide that we're creating through the grant, those will all be no cost because the textbook will be
okay.
Open
yet. So I'm going to step in a little bit. Is that okay? Because open education resources means that they are licensed under a particular license. And it's one of the Creative Commons license, okay? You can actually charge for them. That is not an issue. And some faculty do charge for them in certain ways. And they try to keep it very low, and that is okay. But open simply means that they are licensed under one of the Creative Commons license. And that allows faculty to have freedom with them that they don't normally have. Affordable Learning Georgia has always recognized just bringing the cost down for students. And so they have often supported using things like library resources, which are not truly open, right? These are completely proprietary, but they engage or encourage no additional cost for the students because the library has already paid for them. Now, some of the materials that Chelda and her group are pulling are actually library resources, which means they are not open. They are simply free for the students. However, they have to be very, very clear when they put this out in their packaged material that anyone else looking at this is aware that these particular materials are fully copyrighted. They are not open. And so a person might be able to utilize them in the same way they could utilize any other copyrighted materials, especially under fair use, but they can't adapt them. They can't change them to meet their own standards at their university. They can't make other derivatives of them or anything like that. So it's a delicate balance, especially when you're overhauling an entire program as they are, and even a course. It's nearly impossible to create a really, really strong pedagogy without some sort of proprietary materials making their way in there. Does that make sense? Thanks a little better.
Yeah. Thank you. I'm so excited. I'm like, great. I'm learning as much as I'm sharing. Yes. Thank you, Nikki.
And we have some folks here, my chemist, y'all, can I just brag on my chemistry group? They have rock and rolled with this, and that's who several of our panelists are. So I think we'd love to hear kind of what they are doing in their classes as well, because there's a whole different variety going on with some of these.
Any chemists want to start?
I can go first. I'm Dr. Shehnaz Langil from the Department of Chemistry and Biochemistry, Statesboro campus. And Dr. Whitlock is there and Dr. Ghosh is there, and we are a chemist group. I'll go a little bit about myself and what we have done, and then probably they both will introduce themselves as well. So we got introduced to this group or this idea two years back, and we attended, Christine and Deb attended this particular program arranged by library and CTE for how to apply to ALG grants, or what is actually the open end resource mean. And that is how I got to know more about it. And so we got all the information from the library and the CTE group. We took some points, we back and forth went with Nikki multiple times. And then when the grant came in, we were able to send now, me and Christine has sent two grants, both as PIs. And then I had recently sent one last semester. And so we have sent the grants and we were able to get published, but funded. But the thing is, we had a great support from the library as well as CTE to get this particular thing funded. So if you have any questions about how did we apply it and how did we approach, we will be able to help you. Yes.
And I can expand a little bit on the two that we received in 2019. Shehnaz and I worked together on replacing the textbook for the organic chemistry sequence. And that's a lot. That's the chemistry majors, the pre-meds, the biology majors, and all of that. The textbook was about $200. And so we dropped that down to where they'd get they only have to purchase an online homework system now. So that's for two semesters of organic sequence. And then this past year in 2020, we received another grant to get rid of or to replace the physical lab techniques book that we use. So there's a book where they learn how to set up a distillation and that kind of thing. And so we've made that a no-cost book now, and an OER, I guess, a no-cost OER book now. And so we've decreased, and that went from $118 to $29. So we've helped with the cost for those two.
Yeah, I can go ahead with a little bit. I mean, I would say like an overlapping experience, but with a different course. So basically, like I was working with this textbook transformation grant for the CHEM 1310, which is the general chemistry course for engineers. So I'll start a little bit of background, how I got to know and what was the process and all. So I think Shehnaz forgot. I was not in the program that was run by CTE and library about the OER. So I actually got to know from Shehnaz and our team lead for the CHEM 1310, that means our Gen Chem coordinator for the engineering chemistry course, which is Dr. Beulah Narendra Purappu. So they both kind of informed me, and it was very new to me, and it was like in 2018 fall. So I was like, okay, so what is the process and what it is about, like what am I creating? So it's always like sometimes when you get to learn something new, you are kind of hesitant, like what where to adopt the method, or it's kind of like go with the traditional stuff and all. So it was always like a hesitance at the beginning. But once we, our journey started towards writing the ALG grant. So, and that time, like as a team with Nikki and Jeffrey Mortimore from the library. So we kind of got together and sat and decided what we are going to do or what we are going to write in the grant. So our process basically started with the textbook transformation grant, which is the ALG. So then we kind of started to think like, how is this going to be helpful in our engineering course? So one challenge that and those who taught the engineering general chemistry course, we always had that issue that we never had a perfect textbook in that sense to teach the general chemistry classes for the engineering majors. Because there are lots of books out there which are mostly dedicated to the normal general chemistry classes for the STEM majors, maybe for GOB as well, but not something which is dedicated to engineering majors. I won't say there isn't any, but that does not kind of align with the SLOs that we have for our department or for our course in CHEM 1310. So it was always like in a situation where we had to kind of adjust and compromise with what is available to us. So with this particular grant, we got that opportunity so that we can modify the text according to the needs. So what are the learning outcomes for individual chapters and all, we kind of like modified the course. Now, honestly, when we created after getting the grant on all, so when we start creating the material, we have a base, and the base was from one of the OpenStax books. But the OpenStax book was also dedicated for the general chemistry, like general chemistry class. So we recreated, we curated materials from that particular book. We selected one chemistry book that kind of like would give us some sufficient material to start with. And then we recreated the course, and with the help of Jeffrey and Nikki, we created a LibGuide in the library, like that library website offers. So that's how like we kind of, we're in the process, during this process, like starting to know about the OER, and then getting through the ALG grant. And after getting the ALG grant, we kind of like modified the textbook and went through the textbook transformation. So our recreated textbook was accessed by the CHEM 1310 from spring 2020, we started, we used that as our textbook for the CHEM 1310 course, and that time onwards, they are accessing the materials and everything. So when we were creating the material, we also added like our own end of chapter problems, because with chemistry, a lot of materials or a lot of chapters do come with like problem solve, conceptual questions like that. So we kind of also created our own materials, and we, as a team, we divided each and every chapters. We have our like responsibilities for certain amount of chapters. So we kind of divided our work on that. And then that's not my area of expertise though, but I just wanted to share that we have another team. I mean, within that team, we have the sub team who kind of like went through the evaluation process, the measures, like what the feedback and stuff like that. So during this entire process, the amount of help we got from library is like, oh, can we do that? Okay. So, and they were like, yeah, if you kind of create this kind of website, they will link it to that. And okay. So, I mean, we got to learn a lot during the process as well, while we are also recreating some of the materials.
Chelda, can I add something to this? Okay, there are two, three questions asked by Nancy, and I just wanted to add to that. And I'm very sure like Nikki and Chelda are going to add to this as well. to the both the initial grants, what me and Christine got for organic, and even Deb and the group got for engineering, the PIs do get the salary, like almost everybody who is involved get the salary. And so since the first one, we were very new, me and Christine were very new. And the first time I have to say this, the first time we sent, none of the chemistry got funded. But the good thing is that time there were three times they were having the request for proposal, three times they were rolling it out. So the moment you get the comments, you don't have to wait. You just work on the comments. You have to think about what to do and immediately submit in the next cycle. During this whole process, one more thing happened that we also come to know to the people who are working there, like, you know, who they are in direct touch with you. They want you to succeed. So the reviews are detailed and they help you. So me and Christine and all the faculty members in the OCHEM division got a salary for summer. And as Christine mentioned, this is not normal, but since we had some money left, which we did not realize it in the fringe or something, we were able to hire two undergrad students for assessment. And as Deb mentioned, a suggestion, like this is just a suggestion, if it is a new time, like if you're working for the first time, an assessment person is a must. And if you add library resources and the library liaison and undergrad students, your points for the grants when you're submitting increases. It's in their rubric. So now the people over there have changed. It is only two times they're asking for the grant, but they have made it very transparent and they have made it very straightforward. In other section, I'll also help you give the information about the third grant which I have received, and so we can go into the depth. But that is what I wanted to add, like about the salaries and the undergrad students.
I absolutely agree, and this is a great time for me to tell you that our first proposal was also rejected. I think that's just a part of the problem. I mean, not that it has to happen with everyone, but that the rejection is the kindest rejection you can get, because it's really clear that they want you to actually be funded. And so they're just giving you really clear, specific feedback for how you can modify so that you can be funded the next round.
But Chelda, like once you get used to it, like once you understand their psyche, then you really knew what they're looking for. Then our second and the third proposal did not get rejected. Like it immediately, yes. But the first one is like, oh, like, yeah. Okay, got it. And then they write it also what they expect from you. And then you just try to adapt it accordingly.
I'll also say that it's kind of like a club. Like once you get in, they're so supportive. They try to create like cohorts and friendships and such. And it's actually really nice how enthusiastic that the staff at the ALG is about, and our library, if you haven't met Nikki yet, but how excited they are about this. And so there's just this incredible wealth of support that you get that I would invite you into it.
Yeah. I think you see that in the entire OER community, truly. I have found just amazing support from the entire group. And we do have at least one person that I can think of, and that's Scott in this conversation, who may not have an option of something like this grant, because I don't know if Tennessee is doing that. But we have folks here, and Addie is one of them. She has been pulling OER into her courses even without the aid of the grants. And I'd love to hear from her about what pushed her that direction and what she's been doing.
It was a class I'd been wanting to teach. We had Professor Lee. So I got it last minute for last summer. It's history of historic costume. And I was it kind of all happened a little bit coincidentally, because I didn't really have time to review a book. And the most popular book on the market cost about $150. And I just could not see my students paying that for a 4-week class. So it just that was a lot for me. So I reached out actually to some friends who are teaching the classes, and they started sharing some videos and some open resources and some textbooks that like shorter books you could access online for free. And I just started building it from there. Luckily that is a discipline where there is a lot of stuff out there. You have to filter it and you have to, it takes a lot of time to go through it, but there is so many resources. So I didn't even really know what I was doing until I recently started working with Nikki, and we're going to work on a grant to take a couple of our freshman level classes in fashion merchandising and apparel design. So, but it's worked really well. And the comments that I got for the students last summer were, I got so many emails saying, thank you for not making me buy a book. I love these videos. I never knew that website existed. We can access that at the library because there's a Berg Fashion Library. They had no idea it existed. So there were so many things. So they really enjoyed it. And there's a lot of, I requested the library pay for, what's that platform, Canopy, with the videos? So, you know, you can't access them all right away, but you can request through the library. So they purchased a few of the documentaries for me to use, and I use those for activities. And the students specifically really like video, and then discussion about the video. So that worked really well for me. So I'm just learning that I'm actually using open educational resources. So I'm excited.
Scott, did you want to jump in?
Come in.
I was asking if Scott wanted to jump in on how he's relating to open ed resources. Okay, maybe we'll come back to him. I wanna try to capture something that Addie just said. Sorry, sort of two things. One, Addie, thank you so much for bringing up how students engage this work. It's like, I don't know if you explicitly advertise to them, I'm not making you buy a textbook. And if you didn't, that's even more incredible how they themselves are able to reflect that this is a class that is accessible to me by virtue of not having this financial barrier, right? Because even for like, I don't want to buy a $100 textbook or any book for $100. So it becomes a barrier in terms of interest even. So thank you so much for that. And if anybody else has like really interesting or anything you want to share with how students engage, I think it's really, in a moment, it'll be a good time to share that. The other thing I want to capture that Addie talked about was this notion of the library buying things to put into the course. Because even though like this is, I my understanding of OER is not that we are saying textbooks are bad. Rather, we're saying accessibility is really good. More diverse representation in the perspectives that are being shared is really good. And how do we expand that? And so if there is a chapter in a book that you love so very much, and you think that this conveys it better than anything else, which those chapters exist, then we do have the option to ask the library to buy that book if it doesn't already own it, and then feature that in our library guides or feature our library guides or feature that in the resources that we provide our students. And so there is this like really great way of just being able to have a diversity of texts. And that goes back to that distinction between whether or not it's low cost or no cost. And at least for our Georgia Southern students, it is still open access.
Yes. Is there a problem that links go away during the course? No, Scott. Like once you have created your libguides, and that is where Jeffrey Mortimer has really helped us. Because what Chelda was telling and Addie was telling, I want to add one point. Christine and I, when we started on the textbook transformation grant, we did not have a proper organic chemistry textbook, and which came as a surprise to us on OpenStax or Merlo, which generally these are the things they use. And so we had to rely on one website and one biological emphasis organic chemistry textbook. So Jeffrey and Nikki helped us to link it in such a fashion that now it is hosted on our Georgia Southern LibGuide. And now our book is hosted on Merlo. So this kind of linked really, really well. And so, yeah, so once you have done your material, so rather than linking them, my suggestion will be, and that I understood from Jeffrey as well, that download, make it your own, and then link it in a place that we do not lose the link.
I want to second that. Download it. It's useful. But then the only issue with that, especially if you think about like traffic to a particular site, when we download things, they're not getting that, they're not getting those analytics for who is accessing the text.
Mm-hmm. Makes sense.
Yeah. And I would say that anytime you use internet sources in your class, regardless, you run the risk of a site that is going to go away or the link is going to change or something. So, you know, you do have to check them before you teach that again and make sure things are updated and links are still working. And that's whether you're trying to develop, use OER or not. If you're using internet sources, there is always that risk.
Can I add?
Oh, I'm sorry.
Go ahead, Christine. I was just going to a next
one. Well, I had a question for Chelda. You mentioned earlier too that you monitor the use of these resources. How do you do that?
Okay, this Nikki, you're gonna have to jump in. More than we monitored it, we asked the library to help us and give us the feedback.
That's smart.
Yes. Yeah.
Recently, Nikki shared the web analytics data with us. So since our textbook for the Chem 1310, which is in the library, in the library guide, there is a section where you can check the web analytics. That means like for a certain period of time, you see like how many views were there, like it comes like as a bar graph. So this is where we try to monitor, but I think so Nikki can tell us more about that because I'm not a regular visitor because at presently I'm not teaching that course, but this is where, like where we used to see the views, the number of views.
And can we also see on Folio? Because ours are linked in Folio, so we can, right? I think you can do that. I just never have done that, but yeah.
We usually recommend multiple analytics, yeah. So the LibGuides themselves keep analytics. You can have views of particular pages, of particular boxes, of particular assets. And it tells you dates, times, so you can see if there's any kind of connection between when you told them that a test was coming up and when they looked at it. We also have Deb's library guide connected to Google Analytics. So that's an extra set of analytics that comes in at least once a month telling about the same thing. These are the assets that were accessed. This is how long they stayed on there, were they successful in their search or were they bounced off, whatever, things of that nature. And then of course, Folio does some of the same thing. So you're getting multiple analytics. And then I would also recommend just some of those qualitative analytics from your students if possible and get their feedback. Get their feedback on the course materials and how they're using them and if they feel that using them contributes to their success within the course and things of that nature.
I want to add two things to that. I'm sure you already know, but in Folio, you can literally go to one particular student and see all of their specific analytics.
Yes.
This is great when somebody wants to like say they've been a stellar student, but what you're receiving doesn't reflect that.
The minutes and how many times they have logged in.
Yeah, like 7 minutes for a whole semester. Come on, but the other thing that I wanted to share was with the analytics, it helps you to understand what resources are exciting to your students and maybe what resources aren't. And so what I do in my courses is I typically do a mid-semester, like week 8, 3-question survey where I ask what's working, what's not working, what do you think about the resources? And when I ask that question, they have the option to also offer resources. We really encourage independent student research for a lot of the concepts we're teaching. And so it's really nice because then students give you ideas all the time about what they're interested in. Also, it's a great way to get them to vent now as opposed to the end of the semester.
Hey, I had a comment here in Tennessee. We are not allowed to do anything without a statement of accessibility. I can't buy any electronic resource, et cetera, et cetera. How do you ensure that these open education resources are accessible to your students? Or do you have to prove it before you put it on your course?
Very good question.
Nikki?
Sure. As you probably know, Scott, if you're using LibGuides, they do follow most of the ADA accessibility guidelines. So our faculty who have created these materials on the LibGuides, they can be read by screen readers. They can, do all of those things. Images are supposed to have alt tags in them, all of those things on there. We usually also try to provide an alternate format if at all possible. And again, and especially for us, I mean, Tennessee, after living there, that was Tornado Alley, but we deal with hurricanes as well as other things that come up. And so there is the very real threat that our students may not have internet access, our faculty may not have internet access. So whenever possible, we like to place these in alternative formats like a PDF or a different type of document, plain text document even, so that that is also accessible in that format if they can't access it electronically. But yes, ALG, Affordable Learning Georgia, has accessibility also worked into their grant requirements. And so they are looking over these things to make sure even things like PowerPoints, proper headings are used, image credits are given, alt tags are given for all images and things of that nature. They highly encourage working with instructional designers if possible, since many of these go on the internet so that you know that they're designed properly for online and internet use. So accessibility is a big issue within the OER world, period, and most people are really doing the best they can to make sure these things are accessible.
Does Folio have a mechanism to check? Like here in Tennessee, we've got Blackboard Ally to check our websites, our LMS. Can Folio check too?
Yes.
Don, you brought a very nice point. I need to ask you one question on that. You said the instructional designer need to be there. Do we have one?
Debbie counts right now.
Debbie Walker. Because I know we lost one.
As I was saying, she's bringing this up, Scott, because our Center for Teaching Excellence has had some folks move on to other positions, and we're in a little bit of a hiring stay because of our friend COVID. So we've lost some folks, but yes, Debbie does count in that. And she has a couple of folks still on the Armstrong campus. I'm pretty
cool to know.
Who also fall in that. But she is short-staffed right now. You're correct in that, Shanaz.
And Nikki, that leads to my next question. Folks from Statesboro campus can get instructional designer from Armstrong campus.
We're all one university.
Good.
Absolutely.
And that leads to my third question. Can we put them in our grant? Because I know that we certain, like for you, we put your, by the way, Nikki's in all three grants. So can they be put as a faculty member or like stages like you? We can't pay you.
It's same thing. They can be as well. If you're worried about who that person would be, since Debbie is officially your instructional designer champion through ALG, you can always just add her name.
Sure. Okay. Good to know. Chelda, I have one more information to provide to the group because it was a little different than what we are talking about, but it did came through an ALG grant. And I don't know how many of you guys are planning right now to send in the coming year, which is in October, because the March 1 deadline just passed. The third grant which I received was not for textbook or not for a supplementary material. I'm purposely saying this because the third grant we received, it was because of COVID situation and for the undergraduate research students, we are developing in summer the professional development activities series, like a 10 weeks course. But it is not like a real course. Anybody can go and have a access to it, but it was needed because the undergraduate students did not get the professional development activities last summer. So here is what happened. Since it was not a textbook, and this is like internal information, I talked to the people directly, one-on-one, the program officer, and the both the people who are the lead there, I talked to them, and we were always on a shaky ground because it was not a textbook, it was not a supplementary material to be funded. But since it was a COVID situation and we had talked directly to them, rather than getting three reviews, I got only two reviews and it got funded. So sometimes when you are iffy about stuff, I went through Nikki, obviously. I kind of informed her and Nikki said, talk to them directly. And then we arranged a time. They agreed like immediately and we discussed about it. The PO also said like, he's not sure, but when they looked at our proposal, they were kind enough. And so we got only two reviews and we got funded. So if you have a very out of the box ideas and it is not fitting into somewhere, please directly talk to them, talk to Nikki, talk to Chelda, and Debbie Walker is the third one, right? So see if you can get through them. And since they say it's so, they kind of help you, like you become a part of a club kind of stuff, they kind of guide you what to do next.
And since Scott asked this, I put it in the text, but I'll make sure this is on there. For those of you who haven't done this yet, they don't have to be in a library guide. These particular faculty members have chosen to use a library guide because they liked the format. They felt it was easy to update. They felt students were comfortable with it. Doesn't have to be ALG with host. They don't care basically how you host it as long as it is open and available. So it can't simply be in the learning management system, because of course that is not open, that's only available to our students. So it has to be in something else, but again, ALG is an option. They will allow you to host on their platform. You could use something like Pressbooks or Lumen if you decided to use that. Our digital repository, depending on what you have created and what is available, can also host. So you have a you have options.
Are the LibGuides put into the folio? I mean, is that how they are accessed by students?
We intended to sort of just have it as a link in where we would normally list a textbook in the syllabus, we just put that link for the LibGuide. And then throughout our modules, for whatever learning management system you're using, you can still like have a direct link to whatever section of the LibGuide you want students to go to.
Thank you.
To add to Scott's question, Christine and I, the first textbook was completely on folio, but when we submitted our final report, they kind of told us folio won't work because it was like a closed system and it was only for instructor based, right? Only in the organic chemistry, it kind of moved. So we had to transfer all the materials to LibGuide.
And we had a similar situation. So for the first grant we did, we were creating, there were like about 10 sections of this one course taught by a variety of faculty with a variety of expertise. And so we wanted to create a folio shell so that any faculty member could jump in and already have the majority of the activities and the resources there for them. So we did build it all in folio. And then where we compromised was we also used whatever external resources there were and we put them in a digital commons page.
Chelda, again through library, right? Digital commons?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. I wanna, for those who haven't fully engaged, I wanna sort of point out a couple of things. Shana's, thank you so much for sharing that. There is the initial like replacement of a textbook. That's the most common grant that there is. But then there is the idea of coming back to revise and improve upon those resources. So that's the supplemental. And then the last one where what I'm hearing and learning about, so thank you so much, is that if there's, especially in time of COVID, but if there are these really creative and out of the box ways that you can think about supporting your students to have greater access to the best resources, perhaps you can have the opportunity to make a direct pitch and our library folks will support us to be able to negotiate that conversation. You might be feeling overwhelmed right now if you've never done this before. So one of the things I wanted to say is my experience since I've been at Georgia Southern and since I've been working with Open Ed Resources is that no matter how short staffed our library folks are, they are so helpful and willing. Like we'll literally hold your hand. You could start with just a basic question of where do I start? And our library folks will send you a link. We'll set up a meeting with you. They will come to your meeting. They will tutor you through the process. So I don't want you to feel like you have to figure this out on your own. Nikki, correct me if I'm wrong, but I feel like this is maybe part of the work that you signed up to do, right? So you'd actually be helping our library folks do their job when you engage them.
Yep, and Scott, I know you're not a part of our system, but again, the OER world is incredibly open. Just reach out. I'm happy to get you in touch with some people that I know if you wanted to explore this more. I have placed some things in chat as we've been going. If you didn't catch those, don't worry. I will send those materials out to all participants in this session, okay? So you'll get those later.
I want to like share a hack. because ALG is an external grant, keep in mind that you can couple it with internal opportunities and funding to enhance the experience. So for instance, one of the things that I'm looking into is that our Office of Inclusive Excellence has like this seed grant. I think it's up to $700 for you to do some work, whatever you think would advance their mission. Well, especially for my chemistry folks, but really for everyone, a diversity of perspectives in all fields is a really good thing, right? Like our university is trying to really promote inclusive excellence. So again, this notion of textbooks being written by one or two or a team of people is usually not going to be reflective of women, folks from religious minority groups, folks from non-white communities. And so it's a good idea to pair your ALG work with that kind of a grant if you wanted to spend some extra time or hire a student to find anyone in that field where you want to bring that perspective in. Alternatively, maybe your college is also having opportunities for some grant work to revise a course or revise a program. You can pair that together. ALG is not offended by this. They're like, whatever just makes it better, right? And I know that the library sometimes has opportunities too. So you could be doing this, you could be working on the exact same thing and it's funded by three different people.
Chelda, can I add something to it? Actually, you gave a very nice idea. The FDC faculty development grant, or the summer one, which I don't know whether they will have it or not this time, but last summer they did not have it. So our textbook is done and everything. And so my majority of the time, like I lead OCHEM 1 and Christine leads OCHEM 2. Like this is how we have divided the work since the beginning. And so if you have brought some additional resources like ancillary material, and if it did not get funded, like use the similar kind of setup or write-up if it did not get funded, like, you know, and you can use that for the FDC grant. You can also use it for, recently somebody was telling me about like this, they might have some summer funding, which comes from CTE or library, I don't know from where it comes, but they do have something. And individual colleges have some internal money for summer. So if you want to pull that together. So thank you about the OIE one.
Yeah, a lot of institutions have added them, Scott. I don't know what's available in Tennessee right now without looking. There are even federal grants for OER. I did want to address a couple of questions in chat, just in case y'all aren't reading them. Dr. Rowling asked, how has perusal been used in this? Perusal would work greatly with this, either as an assessment option or simply engaging students in what is called open pedagogy, where you're actually engaging your students and having them help create information and materials. And there are examples of entire OER textbooks out there that were co-written by students within classes and then peer-reviewed by students and faculty and put out there. So this is a great opportunity to really engage students, like Chelda said, and get their feedback and see what's important from them and get their perspective on a lot of things. And Scott did ask what Digital Commons was, and Scott, that is simply our institutional repository at Georgia Southern.
We only have a few minutes left, and so I really want folks to feel free to jump in, especially if we haven't heard from you.
I just just wanted to mention just briefly, the grant that Shannon's was talking about, it came out in the faculty development one. It came out in an email yesterday, I believe, or first thing this morning. So they are doing that. There are funds for it.
The one which they sent yesterday, Eddie, their due date is wrong. Completely wrong. Because it's February something, and I'm like, why are you sending it today? Because the due date was last week. So I wanted to write it, but I'm like, keep quiet. Let's see. Like, they'll change on their own.
Basically, there is an extension coming up.
Yeah. There is an extension coming up. Chelda, can I chime in for one more question? Because this really helped us. Who is sending grant like this year?
I'm going to submit one in the fall.
Fall. Christine sent it in March, right, Christine? Yes. Anybody else? My really one important help I can provide you is get in touch with people. Like, get in touch with people, call the library, call the CTE folks, whoever has sent it. I won't say it's an easy grant to get, but if you know, even 1 month ahead of time, this grant is very easy to get. I won't say easy, there is work involved, but you know what I mean, like it is possible to get. And second thing is, which we came to know through COSM and after we applied, and Christina and I came to know like a little bit further along, this is considered as an external grant. This is not an Georgia related grant. So anybody who is looking for like, you know, external grant, this is the grant which is possible to get. The rate is very high to get, and I have seen consistently Georgia Southern does get grant.
Anything else before we wrap up?
I have a question, like probably I'm thinking more while doing the modification of the text and materials. It sometimes feel like, can we maintain the quality of the materials? For example, like, can we be up to the standard of the conventional textbooks to what we are creating? I mean, it kind of like comes up, I mean, it's in my mind for some time, but probably like when we recreate or curate the material, we try to provide best up to the standard of our student level, how they can grab, or kind of like depending upon their preparedness and all. So that is one question that I always try to kind of think about it, is when we are curating the material, can we are we maintaining the quality of the content like that? If, I mean, any suggestions or anything that you can, or from your experience you have?
I think.
Go ahead, Chelda.
So the one thing that I would say about maintaining the quality of the materials you offer to students is to continue to confer back to what is the quality within textbooks, because that's still the standard, right? That's the norm. And so if if you find that your colleagues, maybe at Georgia State or at Kennesaw State, are still using the textbook, and you were to ask the question, well, what is it that this textbook is giving? Then you can measure that up against the materials that you're sourcing. Like, does this still accomplish it? And perhaps accomplish it in an even better way.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
All right, everyone. I am going to stop recording right now.